Today, we are going to look at this very interesting process that we call data analysis. To me, this is indeed very interesting, but what I have noticed over the years with students is that they are quite afraid of this process of data analysis. I have always seen that there is great excitement when collecting the data, going out to the field, finding out what is happening. But when it comes to actually crunching the numbers, apparently everybody seems to get a little frightened. It is an extremely interesting process, and we are going to walk through it today. Let us see what we really have to do to analyze data. Of course, first we need to describe it. We need to say what exactly it is that we have found. What are the typical or average scores that we have seen? What sort of spread of scores do we have? What is the range? And so on. So, description of data, description of all our findings. Then we want to also summarize them. We want to have a quick, crisp summary of what exactly it is that we have found. After which, we want to evaluate it. We want to make meaning of it. We want to take a look and understand what it is that this data is speaking to us about. What is it telling us? And finally, we want to all draw our conclusions for our study based on this data. Why do I say that data analysis is a matter of looking at the numbers and also at the logic behind what exactly it is that you're trying to see? The reason is that we must not forget that data analysis is not necessarily only quantitative. We can also have qualitative data analysis. And for that kind of data, as you see on the slide, sometimes we have bunches of actual written material, diary entries, and so on. Of course, the methodologies that we then use for this qualitative data analysis are completely different. And today I'm going to focus largely on quantitative data analysis. So as I was saying, what we often do after that is we try to pictorially, visually try to represent what our data looks like. So we may use bar graphs, we may use pie charts. All sorts of data can be displayed through this. As you will see in the various examples, it can be weather, it can be climatic conditions, it can be market conditions, how much a particular product has sold, or what sort of people have bought that product, and so on. So data analysis is not restricted by the field or the medium or the science that you wish to study. The methodology remains the same, and that is what we are going to study today. Once we begin this process of data analysis, the very first and very important question that we must address is what sort of scales are we looking at? How are we actually measuring whatever is the variable that we are trying to measure? We all know, and I think this is very basic to everybody, but it's very important to look at before we attempt our data analysis, that we have essentially four kinds of scales. Let us see what they are. We have nominal scales, ordinal scales, interval scales, and ratio scales. We all know that nominal scales are merely to label, to give an understanding of what sort of variables we are looking at. For example, if we have coded our variables as male and female, 1 and 2, or 1 and 0, whatever it is the code that we are giving it in our data sheets, that is a typical nominal entry. Or if we are grouping our sample by the language they speak, by the religion they espouse, or the domains, the areas where they stay, the localities, all these can be nominal variables. So keep in mind that nominal variables, as the name implies, are just names, they're just labels. And we are not talking about any sort of direction. So if we give male a score of 1 and female a score of 2, no use at all? For example, if we have ordinal scales, can we not do any kind of analysis with it? Of course we can. For example, when you have frequencies, when you're analyzing the frequencies of data, for example, how many boys and how many girls attended school, or how many college students and how many school students show interest in a certain football match, or whatever is the data you want to analyze, you can use nominal data as well. So basically, for example, you're looking at statistical analysis. So then one might ask, do nominal scales have no value? Can we not use that data at all? Then why are we collecting it? No, of course not. Nominal scales can be used. For example, if we have frequencies of data like gender, how many boys and how many girls attend school, or if you might have an age group, for example, do school or college students, what frequencies of school and college students show interest in a particular TV program or in a particular football match. So these are frequencies, and one can do even statistical procedures like a chi-square or a McNamara using these frequencies. So data of all sorts is useful. It is important that you are master of that data and you know exactly how to use it. Now let us go a little further. Now what we are going to see is a large table, and I'm going to dwell on that table for some time. So we are going to look at that table for a little while, because I want us to understand how various kinds of scales, various kinds of measures can be subjected to different kinds of statistical analysis. And what you will see in this table is that for the very, very simple kind of counting that we do, like for example, tally marks, which is a very, very basic kind of analysis we can do, over there only certain very descriptive statistics is possible. But as we go higher and as we want to use more of interval and even ratio scales, then we can do more complicated statistics, and as we are going to see later in today's talk, perhaps use factorial designs or use different kinds of correlations or regressions or comparisons of various scores. So as I said earlier, one must be very clear what level of scale, which kind of scale one is using, in order to be safe and use the correct kind of, the appropriate kind of statistics later on. So that is why I have left this table on for you in the slides for a little while, for all researchers to take a look at which exactly is the kind of scale that I plan to use. Other than this, what other important decisions do we have to take? We need to look at the actual scatter of the data. We obviously want to look at the central tendency. We want to see what is the mean, the median, the mode. All these are different ways in which we can describe a distribution. Later we are also going to look at the normal distribution. All of us have studied normal distributions at the very basic level of statistics. We all know that, for example, in normal distributions, mean and median and mode coincide and it's perfectly bilaterally symmetrical and so on. But this is an important thing to study. Looking at the spread and the kind of distribution that we actually have, other than central tendency and of course variability or range that we said, which is usually described in terms of variance or in terms of standard deviations, what we often look at is whether the data is distributed in a way that is non-normal. Two good examples of this is what we call skewness and kurtosis. So on your slides, you have examples of skewed distributions. Distributions that have all the data piled up to one end and not exactly in the center are called skewed distributions. For example, if all your data is piled up at the higher end of the scale, then we would say we have a negative skew. And if all the data is piled up at the lower end of the scale, which means the tail of the distribution is kind of going towards the higher end of the scale, then we call it a positive skew. So for skewness also, we have different ways of measuring skewness, talking about how skewed our distribution is, and based on the amount of skewness, we will take a decision of what sort of statistics to use. For example, parametric or non-parametric, and we are going to come to this in a little while. The other distribution that we have is kurtosis. So just as skewness was the horizontal distribution of the data, kurtosis is like the vertical distribution of the data. So you can have tall distributions, flat distributions. So we call a curve like a normal distribution, we call it a mesokurtic curve. That means it is neither too high nor too low. Or we can have a platykurtic distribution, which means the kurtosis is very low. The height of the curve is not very much. This also will determine what sort of statistical analysis we plan to apply to our data. So again, very quickly to summarize, in this slide we looked at the kind of distributions we have, the central tendency, the variability, the skewness, and the kurtosis. So far we understood that we not only describe our data in this numerical fashion, like I said, a skewness or a kurtosis score, but we can also show it graphically. So we can have box plots, we can have scatter plots, we can have box and whisker kind of plots, stem and leaf. So there are a variety of different ways in which data can be plotted, and we should also very, very clearly show our data in this manner. Always one has to keep our ultimate audience in mind, friends. So for example, if you're sending a paper to a journal for publication, the journal may have a limit on how many figures, how many graphs, how many tables they can have. But when you are describing your own values, say in your research thesis or, you know, in some place where this demonstration is important, then it is very good if you can highlight all these characteristics of the data. Now going further, we are going to a very, very important part of data analysis, which is actually where you now begin to draw inferences. So what we saw so far was called descriptive statistics or descriptive analysis, and now what we are going to go into is called the inferential analysis. In inferential statistics, we have to take a number of decisions. We have to, for example, cite the confidence interval with which we can be really confident of the kind of range of our data. For example, I might estimate based on my population parameter and on my sample statistic where exactly the data descriptor will lie and how much to the higher and to the lower end it is likely to vary. So to what sort of confidence interval can I limit my findings? With how much confidence can I say that my population descriptor, my statistic which I am drawing from it by sampling from the population, how likely it is to lie between this higher and this lower point? So to use statistical language, if I have a mean, which is my sample statistic, and I have a mu, which is my population parameter, what are the chances of the two being this similar to each other? That is what my confidence interval tells me. I'm also going to be able to talk about statistical significance. I'm going to be able to talk about in inferential statistics, how importantly, how clearly I'm able to say to the degree to which I'm sure of my findings. Usually in statistical journals, you find a p-value, you find the probability of the findings being significant. Usually by a rule of thumb, we use a p-value of 0.05 or 0.01, and that is what we are going to look at next. So statistical significance, confidence intervals, all these are aspects of inferential statistics where, once again, we are drawing conclusions based on population parameters. That means we are drawing conclusions about what the population is likely to look like based on that small sample which I have drawn out of that population. While doing this, a researcher is liable to make certain errors. And these errors are very important to look at before we go further. In very simple basic statistical textbooks also, you will come across this terminology that says type 1 error and type 2 error. What does this really mean? We are going to see this on a slide in a form of a table to make it really simple for you. But let us see what a researcher does, what sort of mistake a researcher may make. When a researcher does a type 1 error, what they do is they reject a null hypothesis which is actually true. That means there is really no difference in the two means that you were trying to compare, but you reject that null hypothesis and you say no, there is a statistically significant difference. We are going to look at through examples what such a mistake might cost us. And we have to take a decision then whether to lean towards a type 1 error or to lean towards a type 2 error. Nothing is easy, friends. It's like a tightrope walk. So you can't say, no, I'm going to eliminate type 1 and type 2 errors. That doesn't work. You might lean towards one or the other depending on what is the cost of that error. So then what is the type 2 kind of error? That is accepting a null hypothesis that is actually false. So that is the kind of error the researcher is making. And that is what we are actually going to see in this table that we have on your slide. So now I think we understood what type 1 and type 2 errors really are. When do these errors really happen? Usually type 1 errors happen when you have a very stringent alpha value. Typically in social sciences, we tend to choose p is less than 0.01 or p is less than 0.05. That is the level of chance that we are willing to accept. What does this p-value actually mean? We are going to look at it once more. But all of us know that it means that we are willing to accept that there is a 5% possibility that these findings are due to chance. Or if my p is less than 0.01, I am saying there is a 1% probability or 1% possibility that my findings are due to chance. But if I make a very stringent alpha, if I say p less than 0.001, 1 in 1,000, okay, or even more stringent than that, I am very likely to make a type 1 error. In contrast, when I take very small samples, there is a chance that I make a type 2 error. Let us see what kind of examples will really throw light on this. Let us take the example of a hospital, okay, where a person is very sick, he's lying in bed, he's undergoing all sorts of treatment, the family is very desperate and they are approaching the doctor to say, can there be a change in treatment? Now here we have a doctor who is saying no, whether it's treatment 1 or treatment 2, it's not going to make any difference. So in other words, the doctor is accepting a null hypothesis. He's saying there is no difference between treatment 1 and treatment 2. In reality, there is a difference and it is being missed. What can happen? The patient might lose his life because there was no change made in the treatment regimen. Now you might have a more experienced doctor who has come in, who has seen hundreds of cases of this sort. So you see your sample has gone up. And based on these hundreds of cases that the doctor has seen or examined or looked at, the person says, no, my experience shows me that the second treatment, treatment B, is actually more effective. So going against the decision of the first opinion, this person says, no, let us shift to treatment B. I do not accept a null hypothesis that there is no difference in these two treatments. I am going to go with rejecting that null hypothesis. And sure enough, you might find that the patient survives. So you see, where there is this kind of a decision, a very crucial decision that you have to take, you have to really seek this fine balance between a type 1 error and a type 2 error. And there, what will matter from our point of view as a researcher is what sort of sample sizes we take, what sort of p-values, probabilities of chance that we accept, and so on.